I'm Robin Shrestha, one of the core developer at CAST Teams. So today the topic is data validation sanitization, and there are some reasons why I chose this topic to present in this session. Actually, what we see in the websites are that the most of the themes that are in the free themes list in the codex, we see that the themes that are approved are properly validated and sanitized. So they are in the list of the popular themes, so they are in the list of the new themes. So why can't we also submit a theme and make our theme on the most popular themes? So why can't we do that? So the reason, one of the reasons I found that most of the theme being rejected so that they cannot publish their theme on the WordPress.org repository was that their theme were not properly validated and sanitized. This is one of the key important factors that I found themes being rejected. So I was also a little bit of confused when we submitted two themes on the free themes list, and we are also being rejected sometime, and I researched over the topic that, so what actually is data validation and sanitization? So I researched over it, and I found in the codex the information was not so properly described over there, and the information was not so good. Actually there was information, but they didn't make me clear. So I thought about it, I researched over the internet and found some pretty much good information that I pasted over in my two articles that I released in WordPress, and over today I am here, I want to share the same knowledge and ideas that I gained from those two articles. Basically, I'll be talking about the overviews, and here are the definitions. First goes, then why data validation and sanitization. So I'll be talking about the definitions, I'll be talking about the differences between them, then I'll set out some golden rules so we can follow and we can make our website so secure. And the last, I'll be showing some helper functions in the codex to help make our website more secure. So here's the definition part. So what actually is data validation? So data validation is to make sure that we receive what we expect to receive. It is a process. It is a process by which you will be asking user to give me something, some data, and you will be checking that if the data is correct or not, if the data type is right or not, if the data size is right or not. You will be checking all those things. And if the data is in the correct format, if the data type is all good, then what you do? You accept the data and you paste it in the database. That's data validation. So what is data sanitization? Sanitization means we take the data from the user. So if it contains an evil tags, so if it contains some scripts, injected scripts, then what we do is we just differentiate those things. We'll just select out all those evil tags, we'll separate it and we'll save it in the database. The word here, same, is referred to means that the code that we are using does not contain any malicious code. So it is safe to be stored in the database. So it does not create any hamper in the database. And also, that is before storing to the database, we make the data same. And what we do is, we also make the data same before echoing it to the browser, so that the browser does, the website does not break, our website does not crash. So the word escaping is used over there, and there are lots of escaping functions in the WordPress. You can use those all escaping functions, so don't get confused when I say that escaping. It is also part of sanitization. Why validate and sanitize data? Why should we validate? It's not only in the WordPress that we should validate and sanitize data. It is important in all the other languages. Like if you go to the core PHP, or you go to the Ruby, or you go to any other language, then security is one of the important thing. You should validate and sanitize the data everywhere, because that's one of the most important parts. Because users do not want their website to be hacked because they are using your themes. They don't want your website to be hacked because they are using your plugin. And I don't think any developer wants that. So here's the point. I have listed some of the things that what can a hacker do if they do not properly, if the theme is not properly validated, or if a plugin is not properly validated. So here's the point number one. Hackers can inject various scripts. That is, I'd like to tell about SQL injection or cross-site scripting. And this is a very vague topic. If I'd like to talk about this, then I should keep a different session over this. But what I'd like to say is that SQL injection and cross-site scripting is one of the most common ways that hackers manipulate the code. And here's a simple example. This is a general code, script color hack script. What it does is it creates a pop-up, and that will show that hack information, just similar. That's nothing wrong with that. But what we do if this code is pasted? If you copy this code and paste it in a source box, suppose, or if you paste it in a form that is asking for username and password, if you copy this and paste this there, and if you are successful to send it to the database, then what it does is creates a pop-up like this. It will give you your hook information like this. It will give you session IDs. It will give you some privilege information. And this looks nothing to us, but what hackers can do with this code that we cannot imagine what they can do. This is beyond our imagination. This little piece of information can be used so much by the hackers. So this is just an example how SQL injection or script is injected. They can be hyperlinks or any other ways that can be done. So to stop all this thing, we should properly validate the data. If you are asking for a user to give the username, in what happens if the user inserts some script? So you should be careful about these all things. So the point number two is, can break the output of the website. Sometimes I've seen that when I someone is asking username and accidentally when I type a double quote or single quote and send it, then what it does is it breaks the output. The website won't go crashing like this. Simply by just keeping double quote or single quote. Because what it does is it the script, the SQL tag, the SQL command is stopped over when you insert the double quote or single quote. So this is a simple example. And third is spread malware. If a user is using your theme or he's using your plugin and you do not want him or you do not want users so that his website become a source for malware. Suppose someone injected a script and when you click on the link, then what he does is he's actually downloading the malware. So another user comes, he clicks over there, and what he does is he's also downloading the malware. So like this, malware spreads. So what we should do to stop this is we should validate the data. Simple as that. And here's the difference between data validation and sanitization. I have seen in the internet that most of the people are confused why what is actually data validation, what is sanitization, are they both same or are they both different? And I like to say that in some manner same, in some manner they are different. I like to differentiate over that. Data validation is simply if the data is valid, we accept it. If not, we reject it. That's all. If you're asking for an integer, if you're asking for, let me give your age, and if he's entering, my age is 15. That's not the way. He should enter an integer number. So what it does is, if he enters an age, you should check if that's a text or if that's a script. What you do is, you reject it and you again ask the user, please re-enter the age. That's valid. That means we accept it. If that is true, we will reject it if that's not true. Simple. And we'll again re-ask the user in the validation process. But in the sanitization process, what we do is that we do not ask the user again. What we do is we make our sense that we want this data. Actually, we want this data, so this sort of data are whitelisted and this sort of data are blacklisted. We do that, and what it is, we separate out and we only paste the same data that are saved to the database. So in contrast to database, validation centers don't reject the whole data, but it's to the email tag. That means if you are asking for a simple text, a feedback text, and you do not want anyone to answer some a tag or some HTML tags over there, then what you do is you just reject the HTML tags, you just reject all the scripts, and you just paste the simple feedback into the database. So the point here is that, so if you validate over these things, so if you're asking for a feedback and if you enter some paragraph of feedback and you validate it, suppose you validate it, then what you mean that he enters some script and you are asking the user, again enter the whole feedback, then user become tedious. He do not want to enter the whole feedback again. You will skip out and you will go to another place. So what you do is you just make your own sense and you will just differentiate these are things that I should say, these are things I should not say. So you take the thing that should be saved and you save it to the database. So the user does not become tedious. So in the process, I like to say that, so well, the simple thing that user can re-enter, you would validate mostly. And if the user cannot re-enter the whole text, then you will sanitize it. That's simple. If you are still confused over it, I'll show you a simple example. Here's I'm asking for a name field, I'm asking for a age field, I'm asking for a feedback field. So in case of age field, suppose I've already told you, I have validated the age field and I have sanitized the input field. So if you are asking for an age and if he enters some text, like my name is this, my name is that, something like that, then that's not age, of course, you know. So you will say that, please re-enter the data. You will reject it and you will again ask that, please re-enter the actual data. But in case of feedback, if I enter that, I am this, and blah, 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 something like this, and what it did, I started a script tag, and I also entered a script and I wrote something over there. Then that script may be malicious code. So you should think that as a malicious code and you should, what to do, you should just escape that out. You should not paste it in the database. You will only write that my name is this, my name is that, and you will always escape out all those scripts and you will save that to the database. You do not ask user to again, please re-enter the whole data because you have entered something like this or something like that. That's the wrong way. So you should sanitize all the feedback and you should validate over the age. So this is a simple example. And I've set out some golden rules over here. These are the rules that I like to every developer to or developer, plugin developer to keep in mind so that it becomes a lot more easier. That never ever trust your users. You should not trust your users. what to say that users, even if you should not trust your user, because accidentally you may type anything in the code, you may copy and paste anything in the code. So never ever trust the users. And the number point is validate and sanitize all inputs and escape all outputs. So before you save anything in the database, please check it, whether it's true, whether it's not, whether it's like, this is the type of data you want, whether or not. And what you do is you save the data. And when you echo it to the browser also, you take the data, and if that's correct form, and you will echo it to the browser. You can do it in a, sometimes you can do it in echo URL, echo something like that. And third number is trust WordPress. You can trust WordPress because WordPress has lots of functions that WordPress core has built. You can use those functions securely. You should not have to revalidate it or re-sanitize it. So you should be careful what to use, what not to use. And here's the simple question, what does trust WordPress mean? So the WordPress users might know this is the simple example, the underscore title, the underscore permalink, the underscore attribute, title attribute, and the underscore content. We do not validate these things because they are already validated in the core. The one who have made this function have already validated, so you don't have to rethink or twice think about it. But if you are taking up data from a custom meta boxes that you have created, then there's a point you should validate it. Like if you get post meta, then the things that you are getting are not valid. So you should validate it yourself. You should use functions that WordPress has provided to validate yourself. So this is the simple, what does trust WordPress mean and what does trust WordPress does not mean. So there are things that you should distinguish yourself. So this is all basically depends upon the practice. So how you practice. Practice means man perfect, and that all depends on this. So whether how you code depends on how you become more expert like this. So here I stated out some of the helper functions. These are escape underscore attribute, escape underscore text areas. Please don't get afraid by seeing all these things. These are all nothing so hard. These are escape underscore escaping functions. Actually, escaping functions are used when you echo something on the browser before taking a data from the database, and we do not echo it. We do not just echo it like in the PHP. What we do is we escape it, and that's simple. Escape underscore attribute, what it does, it converts the greater than tag, less than tag, like this into corresponding HTML entities. And it is used to validate attributes term. The word itself clarifies escape underscore attribute. What it does is it escapes the attribute. You can use it in a real tag, or you can do it in a title tag. Like this, you escape. What you do is echo escape underscore attribute. You do like this thing. You do not do echo escape. You do not do echo the whole title. And another is escape underscore text area. You use escape underscore text area when you try to encode the text area. And here's a simple example. Variable dollar attribute, and I have given this a text. This text contain, and I have injected a script, and that's it. Followed XXX script here. So what will happen if I do echo escape text area and close the text area tab? So basically, what the WordPress does inside is this will convert this tag, this greater than tag, this less than tag. It will convert it to its corresponding HTML entities like dollar and LD, dollar and quote and dollar and ZT. Like this, it will convert the double quote, single quote, greater than, less than sign that are that we use for the quote tags, is HTML tags. So simply instead of this script being executed, this script is simply pasted like a text in the browser. This will not be executed as code, this will be simply the browser will read this as a text. So it does not make any harm. So escape underscore text here does this thing. So there is another escape underscore URL. So escape underscore URL, what it does actually is it escapes the URL. If you are trying to get a URL from the database and trying to echo it in the browser, then it simply sanitizes the URL. It will check the protocols, whitelisted protocols like HTTP, HTTPS, FTP, mail2, and like this, there are a list of, you will know this when you view the codex. And if that does not contain such HTTP, then HTTPS or some whitelisted protocol, it will just reject it. And another helper function, escape underscore HTML and escape underscore CS. Escape underscore HTML is similar to attribute. It will also encode the greater than sign, less than sign, and percent, double quote, single quote. And it will render the thing instead of being interpreted as a code. And similarly, there is escape underscore JS. You can use this in inline JS if you are using a inline JS like onclick, do onclick. So onclick, do something. You can use these types of JS. And another is some helper input validating functions. These are for validating. Those are for the this are all for escaping. That means these are for when you echo the data to the database, and these all things are when you take the data and save it to the database. So you do these functions when before saving to the database. So inval apps int, this symbol inval does ensure that the number is integer. Apps int ensures that the number is non-negative. And similarly, sanitize text field. This is mostly, I frequently use this. It, what it does, it strip out all the white spaces, even tags, space. So when a user write my name and he enters a tab or five spaces and keep my name is this, then what it does is it will collapse all these spaces and give just a single space. So the, your data is in a format. So and if you have injected some strip tags, then it will strip out those things. So it is simple. So some other functions are WP cases post and WP cases. These are very popular if you will see in the code. And WP cases post, it does that, it will allow a certain list of HTML that has been already defined in the code, that is simply in the post content, and you can use this. There are defaults, and if you do not, if you want your own HTML tags to be approved, then you will use WP cases. You can pass those as elements as an argument over allowed HTML tags, and you can only allow those HTML tags that you want. Suppose you only want to pass A tag and S1 tag or S2 tag or something like this, then you will be passed those as argument and all other tags will be rejected out. And similarly, there is is underscore email and escape URL raw. Is underscore email, what it does, it basically checks your email is true or not. If it is true, it will return true. If not, if it is false, then it simply checks that your email is true or not. Similarly, there is escape URL raw. So escape URL raw does it. Escape underscore URL, escape underscore URL raw. You might be confused over these two. Escape underscore URL is intended for output purpose. That means when you take the URL from the database and echo it to the browser, you do escape underscore URL. But you do not do the, but what you do in escape URL raw is you take the URL from the user and save it to the database. So before saving it to the database, you do escape URL raw. Before echoing it to the browser, you do escape underscore URL. And there is a simple difference, and that is it does not encode HTML in directly. That's it. And I like to say that I have the sources here. I have covered the Deep WordPress. These are two articles I have written in the Deep WordPress, and I have also some from codecs. And this is a video from Mark Chakwith, John Cave, and Brad Williams. Thank you.